Hey yo, what is going on, viewers of the tube? My name is Tyler and welcome to the channel you wouldn't want to show your mom or the Karens of your own suburb.
I'm horny.
Just like Wubby's newly wrapped car. You know, all right, Tasha, it's time for Chico Crypto. Well, hopefully one day our channel gets as big as Wubby's so I can wrap my car just like that. Nakey anime girls for the win. Well, to get me one step closer to an Natasha car wrap, I better start talking about crypto. Pulling out Bitcoin's chart since Monday. Very nice, I'm horny. It's been a very bullish week, there is no doubt about that. Starting Monday, Bitcoin moved up with little resistance until it hit 9.4K. That was the stop. Since then, we have been hovering in the 9.2K to 9.4K range, which I thought we'd be hanging in the 8.7K to 9.2K range if you watch my Tyler analysis from earlier this week. Well, I was wrong. It was one level up where the range bounce would be. So where is Bitcoin going to go next? Up, down, sideways? Well, if you watched my video on the coronavirus on Tuesday, I discussed how if this becomes a pandemic worse than H1N1 in 2009, Bitcoin will smash through 10K. Now I know some people are like, Tyler, you and many people are overreacting about the virus. It isn't something we should be worried about. Well, all I have to say is watch the movie Contagion and use your brain to understand that this is worse than H1N1 and even SARS. China started building a 1,000-person hospital in weeks when official numbers were just 30 dead and 120 infected. And now they are building a second one with a higher capacity of over 1,300 beds. A first world country quarantining a city of 11 million because of supposedly 300 cases, locking down roadways, digging up those roads, infrastructure, locking down trade, which is costing billions of yen a day. Most of the world is still in the dark with how bad the virus actually is. China is withholding information, without a doubt, and this is already showing its ugly face with the Trump-China trade deal. China, in the deal signed on January 15th, promised to buy at least an additional US $12.5 billion worth of US farm products in 2020, and at least US $19.5 billion in 2021. But US futures prices have since dropped 5% for soybeans and 8% for pork, as China, the world's biggest soybean importer and pork consumer, has failed to make the major purchases from the US. So in my virus video posted on Tuesday, I dove into the two-sided trade deal and the obligations of each. Basically, China would be importing pork and soybeans from the US in return for the US importing raised and slaughtered chickens from China for the first time in US history since the creation of the USDA and food inspection agencies, as the Federal Register confirmed in November. Eligibility of the People's Republic of China, PRC, to export to the United States poultry products from birds slaughtered in the PRC. Under this final rule, slaughtered poultry or parts or other products thereof processed and certified PRC establishments are eligible for export to the United States, effective December 9th, 2019. But since that deal, we haven't seen a single pork or soybean buy from China. And the effect it's having on American markets, American pork futures, they are crashing. Pulling out the 1 month chart, we can see there was a super big pump because of the signing of the trade deal. But since the outbreak of the coronavirus on the 23rd, down baby down, getting almost back to levels before the trade deal was signed. A similar thing can be seen with soybeans. Small spike on the deal signing day, 15th, but since, crash. Not a good sign whatsoever, and China's economy is going to be taking a massive hit from this. According to the South China Post morning article, delays or reductions in China's planned purchases could put more pressure on US farms' incomes that suffered during the country's bruising trade war. It obviously is going to have some ramifications economy-wide, which we hope will not inhibit the purchase goals that we will have for this year, US Agriculture Secretary Sonny Perdue said. But don't worry, remember, there are two sides to a trade deal, and we are getting chickens from China, grown and pumped full of antibiotics in their disgusting factory farm conditions. And we might just need to make some under-the-table chicken deals. US takes a bunch of chickens, and China takes our pork and soy. These under-the-table deals will happen, and they are going to put our public's health at risk. So if I were you, don't buy chicken from any Walmart, Tyson, etc. Buy your chicken from a place like Costco, who has their entire supply chain controlled from end to end, guaranteeing the chicken you buy from there is raised here in the States. It's hilarious to me. Trump and his supporters say America first. Yet if you dive into the complexities of his trade deals, he is outsourcing so much more to China than the previous administrations and presidents for the past quarter century. Importing manufacturing goods is one thing, but agriculture, that is a whole nother level of stupid with how unregulated and relaxed China is with everything. It's not only poultry, people. We are importing fish too. So we have a weird frickin' relationship with China and fish. We have never trusted any fish from China, but we trust them to package our own. Yes, in the past, even before Trump, we would export our freshly killed fish to China, who would then process and package it and then resell it to us. Sounds stupid? Well, it is, because we have an abundance of salmon here in the United States. Well, ever since Trump took office, his tariffs have had some major effects, especially for those salmon industries. Salmon was potentially taxed twice, once when it left the US for China and once when it came back. Well, Trump, as part of his trade deal, quietly allowed China the power to be able to export ciliiforms fish and fish products to the United States. Ciliiforms fish, also known as catfish. As we can see, under this final rule, only raw catfish and fish products produced in certified PRC establishments are eligible for export to the United States. Effective date, December 5th, 2019, right before the chicken. And it isn't only China that gets to, but their buddies too. Vietnam and Thailand. Now I'm sure you're like, what the hell, Tyler? Who eats catfish? Well, some people actually do. And it is a big industry, especially for feed for other fish. It's a lifeline for many people. Zooming in on this map, you get a scope of the industry. Well, what do these US catfish farmers think about the deal? It has been a heated debate going on for over a year now. This article is from September of 2018. Three countries with 30 foreign catfish producers want access to US markets. From the article, domestic catfish farmers say they've been harmed by foreign producers, especially China and Vietnam. In the two most recent farm bills, they persuaded Congress to move catfish inspections from FDA to FSIS. Domestic catfish farmers said the 1%, 2% of seafood products that are subject to FDA is not enough for catfish. Lower in the article, a final decision to make China, Vietnam, and Thailand eligible to export raw ciliiforms fish to the US will at the outset mean opening the American market to 30 foreign catfish processors. China expects 14 of its establishments will be eligible, Vietnam plans for 13, and Thailand expects 3. Well, it is confirmed, my friend, and it's just the beginning. I would expect more agriculture markets to be open to China, as our world is turning into turmoil, and if Trump doesn't get China to buy these goods from the US, we are screwed. And this means the ramifications of all of this are really heating up. Like I mentioned, this is going to be a massive hit to the Chinese economy. The entire Chinese stock market is currently shut down. China frantically shuts down stock market to prevent a coronavirus sell-off. They are kicking the can down the road. From this Yahoo article, they're planning to reopen on Monday, February 3rd. If and when they reopen, the entire world can expect a massive correction. The Dow Jones already took the first hit on the 27th. As we can see, it then settled and even started rising by the 28th. Why? China closed their entire stock market on the 27th. It's going to reopen Monday, and if the virus spreads, it's going to be a gosh darn world of hurt for those traditional markets. But this turmoil and chaos is a good thing for crypto and Bitcoin. I mean, even during the time since I wrote the first Tyler analysis part of this video, Bitcoin has already broken out of that range and is testing 9.5K as I end the video. The Bitcoin contagion is coming, and 10K, in my opinion, is right around the corner. Cheers. I'll see you next time.